gentle marketers. Welcome to episode 27 of the Gentle Business Revolution podcast, the show where we talk about marketing your business by disrupting the current marketing paradigm. I'm Sarah Zinnikroce. If you're new here, I'm your host, and you know that you're in the right place if you are a heart-centered entrepreneur or changemaker who is looking for a different, a better way to market your business. Or you are an entrepreneur who is simply tired of the hypey, pushy, traditional marketing model and are ready for a paradigm shift. You might also be a marketing impact pioneer working for an organization who does business for good, and you're interested in this topic of how to market with more empathy and kindness. On today's episode, I invited Dana Wilde onto the show, and today's episode falls under the P of personal power. If you don't know what I'm talking about, you can download your one-page marketing plan with the gentle marketing version of the 7 P's of marketing at sarahzinnikroce.com/one-page, the number one page. Our personal power is very dependent on our mind and our mindset. I'm sure you would agree to that. That's why I'm so excited to talk to Dana, who wrote a book called Train Your Brain, which I often refer to in the Gentle Marketing Program. And this is really dear to me because I've often been very been very skeptic about the whole idea of the law of attraction and you just got to think positively, and all of that just kind of didn't resonate with me. And when I came across Dana's work that talks all about training your brain and comes from this scientific background, and she did so much research, that's when I was like, okay, I found my person, and yes, I think I can train my brain. So a little bit more about Dana. After growing her own business from $0 to $1 million a year in under 19 months, Dana Wilde now teaches others how to do the same. With nearly 100,000 followers in 68 countries, Dana is the best-selling author of Train Your Brain and is featured in the movies The Abundance Factor and True Prosperity. Fascinated by neuroscience and the power of the mind, she affects lives daily on the Mind Aware Show, her podcast, which I highly recommend, where she interviews thought leaders, brain scientists, and celebrities about how to intentionally think wealthier, happier, and healthier thoughts. We talk about the conscious and the unconscious mind, the difference between training your brain and the law of attraction, what she thinks about feel-good marketing, and she also has a quiz that she calls Your Marketing Superpower, so obviously I had to ask her about that. So without further ado, here's my conversation with Dana Wilde. Enjoy. Hi, Dana. So good to see you.
I'm so glad to be here.
Excellent. Yeah, I can't wait for our conversation. It will be so good. So you're the founder of the Mind Aware Brain Training for Entrepreneurs. So let's start there. Why do entrepreneurs need brain training?
I'm so glad you asked, Sarah. So here's the thing. When I first started getting into the entrepreneurial space here in the United States, I realized that everybody was teaching how to, you know, how to market, how to pick up the phone, how to go to networking meetings, how to build a website, how all this stuff, you know, how to be on social media. And I thought, oh my gosh, nobody is really talking about mindset. You know, if you line up 100 entrepreneurs that are at the top of their game and making bunches of money and oodles of, you know, good in the world, you're going to find that the only thing they have in common is mindset. They're all using different marketing methods. They're all have different ways they got to the top. But the common denominator is that they think differently than other people think. And so I really wanted to teach people how to think differently, because mindset is something you can learn.
That's so interesting. Yeah, I think it's so true. I have this quote in front of my desk that says, set a goal so big that you can't reach it until you become the person who can.
Oh, nice quote.
Right? And it has all to do with mindset. No matter how many, you know, tools you know or skills you have, that's not how you become another person. It's the mindset.
Well, and specifically, Sarah, the key words that I like to use are that they have a different level of expectation for their success. Mm-hmm. So they have a different level of positive expectation. So this isn't about, you know, when we believe in mantras and affirmations, I love mantras, but this isn't about walking around going, abundance is flowing to me, abundance is flowing to me, abundance is flowing to me. This is about really shifting your level of expectation.
So let's talk about that because, yeah, clearly affirmations and the law of attraction is probably something that, you know, maybe you're compared with or that comes up in conversations because that's definitely kind of what's out there. And I personally have always struggled with the law of attraction. So explain to our listeners how what you're doing, training the brain, is different from the law of attraction.
Thank you for asking that because, you know, obviously, you know, I myself personally believe in the law of attraction and these things, but I think sometimes they can feel a little bit woo-woo. And I think that sometimes people think of mindset as, oh, I'm going to sit in a room and meditate and stuff's just going to fall in my lap. And I want to just, when I was going into this, I was hearing a lot of motivational speakers. And they were saying things like, you should believe in yourself and you can do it. And what you focus on grows and all this stuff. But nobody was saying why. Why is it that what you focus on grows? So I wanted to really drive home and make my core point for everybody that I'm teaching about mindset, that your brain is designed for success. And in particular, there's a part of the brain called the reticular activating system that is like a little matchmaker that lives in your head. It's at your service all day long. And when you are thinking about things and talking about things, it's saying, okay, this is important to you. I'm going to look for more of that. And if each of us would look in the room we're sitting in now, or car or whatever, and look at all the sights and sounds and sensations and smells and all the stuff coming at us, we'd go crazy if we had to process all that. Well, our reticular activating system stands at attention, listening. What are you thinking about? What are you talking about? I'm going to look for more of that for you. Mm-hmm. So this is like if you've ever had the experience of looking for a car, sometimes you'll see that car everywhere, or sometimes women get pregnant. They see pregnant women everywhere. I was interviewed by a man recently. He's like, oh my God, we just had a baby and I'm seeing babies everywhere. Mm-hmm. And that's because your brain is designed to look for whatever you're thinking about, whatever you're talking about. And it's just straight brain science.
It's fascinating. You also talk about the conscious and the unconscious mind and how they're clearly different. And so talk to us about how both of them have a role to play and how these roles are different.
Yes, thanks for asking that. So in the unconscious mind, that's like most of our day. Most of us are walking around the day unconsciously. That's the part of our brain that we aren't even aware of it because it like beats our heart and breathe and, you know, all of those body functions. Like imagine if we had to have it on our thing to-do list, you know, breathe, you know, it would be like the worst, right? So it takes care of all that, but it also stores all of our memories and our beliefs about ourselves, all of those things. And so those beliefs we have about ourselves, the reticular activating system also matches those to the outside world. So we like to say the inside picture, the inside world matches the outside world. And so the conscious mind, on the other hand, that's what we usually think of when we think of our brain. That's the part of the brain that is yammering in our head all day long. It's like a little sportscaster, you know, just commenting on whatever we're doing, thinking all sorts of random thoughts. And that's the part that we feel like we don't control. So if some people have said to me, I wish I could turn my brain off. Like I go to bed at night and I wish there was an off button where I could turn it off. That's the thinking mind. The conscious mind is that part of the brain. And so if you want to make change, there are basically three ways to do it. The first method is you can go to the unconscious mind and use modalities that work with the unconscious mind, like hypnotherapy, or, you know, some of these more modern modalities that go straight to the unconscious mind and change limiting beliefs. And they are great. I don't personally deal with those modalities, even though I'm a trained hypnotherapist. My preference is the conscious mind. Mm-hmm. The second place is behavior. And this is the method where you force yourself to do something differently. And everybody uses it from January 1st to January 5th of every year, where you try to say, like, I'm going to go to the gym every day. I'm going to hand out 5 business cards every day. You know, it's not very effective, you know, because it's hard to force yourself to do things. And then the third way is to change the way you think. Because how did we get those unconscious beliefs in the first place? We got them through repetition of thought and repetition of emotion. And when you have a different thought, you create a different emotion, and that creates a different belief. And then the reticular activating system automatically matches that up. And for me, it's the easiest way to make change, because you can do it while you're going about your day. You don't have to go make an appointment with somebody. You know you have proof. Like, for me, the reason I like the conscious mind is if I'm doing a mantra or I'm doing some conscious mind work, when something shifts in my outside world, I go, I know that's because I was doing that. You know, sometimes we don't know why change happens, but what I want to teach people how to do is think in their own heads.
Right. So you mentioned several times now mantras versus affirmations. Maybe sometimes they're the same thing, but in your teaching, you use the word mantra. So explain to us, what is a mantra?
Right. Declarations, incantations, affirmations, mantras, essentially they're the same thing in the sense that they are a short positive phrase designed to create change. And the reason I use the word mantra is because of its history in Eastern culture of actually being something that helps shift consciousness and shift change. So you literally become a different person. But everybody has their own comfort level with words and which words they prefer. When I'm talking about mantra, I'm usually talking about a perfect language mantra, much like, you know, the I am mantras. You know, I am beautiful, I am savvy, I am happy, I am abundant. They're very, very powerful. However, I want to make a really key point, Sarah, that not everybody can say those and feel good. And so for me, the single most important thing is to feel good. And so with the train your brain system, this isn't about walking around being bouncing off the ceiling happy every day. This is about finding a way to shift your mindset and your feelings, your emotions, so that you're consistently more hopeful and above every day, feeling more hopeful, feeling better. You know, it's not about being ecstatic. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, exactly. And I think maybe some of the kind of personal development coaches and work out there, that's maybe why there is some kind of skepticism with that, because we're all smart enough to know that we have bad days every now and then. And so it's like, how do I feel when I'm just so upset and I'm you know, repeating these mantras or affirmations that say, I am happy?
That just the worst.
Doesn't work for most people.
It affirms the other side. Yeah. You know, if you're feeling crappy and you're saying, I am happy, it just makes you feel crappier.
Exactly. And so I love this concept in your audio, and we'll share that with listeners, because you're so graciously sharing that audio book. It's the reading of your book, really, right? So it's not just a free audio file. It's like the whole book, and I've listened to it, and it's just amazing. And so there's this concept that you talk about that's called transitory statement. Mm-hmm. And that was like my favorite part. It's like, finally, like, I felt respected for, you know, being a smart thinker. Like, yeah, my brain, I'll have you explain the transitory statement, and I'll comment on it.
Thank you. I love it that you loved that. It's my favorite part too, because, you know, the train your brain system is basically 4 parts. Part 1, step 1, is the wake up call. We have to start being more awake and aware of what we're thinking about. You know, we care about the clothes we wear, the food we eat, all this stuff. I want you to care about the thoughts in your head. Step two is you have to decide, do I want to keep matching up this belief in my mind? And if you don't, then step three is where all the quote unquote work is. That's where you have to find a way to talk about the current situation in a way that feels good till you get to step four where you feel good. So step three, if I'm saying something like, all my clients are broke, or I hate marketing, or I can't get clients, or this is harder than I thought it's going to be, it's hard to go from that to I'm signing up clients every day. I mean, that's just ludicrous. It's ridiculous. So what we try to do with the transitory statements is we try to give people a way, and we give several of them in the audiobook, but my favorite one is using the word but. We try to give people a way to talk about the current situation, but also affect change. So for example, let's say you hate marketing and you keep saying, I hate marketing, I hate marketing, I hate marketing, I hate, it's no wonder I don't have any clients because I hate marketing. Well, if you keep doing that, your reticular activating system is going to match that up. So you have to find a way to say something different. So instead of going, I love marketing, right? What we suggest to do is use the word but, which the word but is a power word. The brain doesn't hear anything that comes before the word but. It only hears what comes after. So if I say, I hate marketing, but clients are finding me anyway, my brain only hears clients are finding me anyway. Or I hate marketing, but things are working out for me. I hate marketing, but I'm still making money. I hate marketing, but I don't need it because my clients love me. I hate marketing, but I get referrals. I hate marketing, but I'm still making money. I mean, you can go on and on and on with that. And now what happens is train your brain isn't about saying, you need to be different. You're a procrastinator, you should change. You're disorganized, you should change. You're hate marketing, you should change. You don't like social media, you should change. You're not techie, you should change. That's crap. That's what the rest of the world is telling you to do. Right. What we're telling you to do is be who you are, but talk about it in a way that still launches you for success. You know, you don't need to change. What if the thing that you think is your biggest weakness is your biggest strength? Yeah. You know, how do you know? You don't know, but as long as you talk about it in a way that doesn't allow it to be your biggest strength, that's what the problem is. So we like to say the problem is not the problem. The problem is that you keep thinking and talking about the problem. And when you use transitory statements, you can believe them. You can believe what you're saying and you can feel like, oh my gosh, you mean I don't have to be techie, but my clients can still find me? Like, what a relief, right?
Exactly. Yeah, no, I love this so much. And my favorite one, together with the but, is the I don't know what I'm doing differently, or I don't know why. But now, for some reason, I'm attracting a higher level client.
Right? I love that one too.
It's not making something up. It's just happening. I don't know why. And so that's.
Yes. One of my favorites is something has shifted. I don't know what's going on, but something has shifted. I don't know what's happening, but something has shifted. Because your brain knows what that something is.
Exactly.
We like to say, I don't know what I'm doing, but I'm doing it.
So good. And then you recommend this app, which I obviously have on my phone, ThinkUp. And link to it in the show notes. So this app called ThinkUp, where either they have recorded statements or you can record your own mantras. And then, just while you're walking, listen to them. And that's how you retrain your brain.
So, yes. Because when you think differently, and it doesn't take a lot, you know, I called my company the mind aware, not the mind happy. Because if you can shift, you know, brain scientists estimate that we are unaware, we're unconscious, 95 to 99% of the day.
Wow.
So if you can take that little bit of time where you're actually aware, and if you can shift it even by a half a percent, we start to see just radical changes. It doesn't take much to start to see that reticular activating system is just waiting for you to think about something that it can look for in the mucky muck.
So good. Yeah.
Sarah, words alone cannot express how profoundly grateful I am and how blessed I feel for this incredible opportunity, your Gentle Marketing Revolution program, and the incredible community around it. Honestly, this program and tribe is exactly what I needed. It's been a really long time since I felt so excited, so confident, as well as so hopeful about my path as an entrepreneur and the importance of being around my own type of people. And I can't believe how excited I am to do all the assignments and the heavy lifting. Thank you so much, Sarah.
The Gentle Marketing Revolution program helped me let go of my internal shoulds and to just focus on the marketing strategies that work for me, the ones that I'm really comfortable with. I really gained clarity on how everything I do in my business always connects to my purpose and to who I am. It's a great program.
The content is both fundamental and strategic. It has helped me to make sure I have the basics in place so that putting myself out there feels much easier and less intimidating. It's strategic because it covers all the key decisions a marketer needs to make in putting together their plan. I highly recommend this program, both for people starting out and for those who might be dissatisfied with their current marketing efforts and outcomes.
The best part of Sarah's Gentle Marketing Revolution is that she combines a truly heartfelt and authentic approach to what can be a daunting subject, marketing from the inside out. I felt welcomed and inspired, ready to put more of me out there. I made some great contacts and friends with people I feel aligned with, and several business opportunities have already been the outcome of these new friendships. Thank you, Sarah, for a wonderful program. I highly recommend it.
You wouldn't be listening to this podcast if the cookie cutter, fear-based approach was still working for you. Whether you are just starting out or have been in business for a while, this program will help you set the foundation to attract like-minded clients and then become the person who can reach bigger goals, whatever they are. Check out the details at thegentlemarketingrevolution.com, and if your intuition calls you to join us, I'd love to have you. I want to take the last couple of minutes to talk about feel-good marketing, because like we discussed offline, it's such a serendipity kind of moment that you just started talking on your podcast about this concept of feel-good marketing. Yes. So you have published two episodes that kind of talk about reframing how we do marketing. And again, it's very much in line with what you're doing with Train Your Brain. It's we want to feel good, right? And so we also want to make our clients feel good. And so you really share this amazing reframe on how we, instead of using pain and manipulation and fear, that's how we, you know, are taught to do marketing in most occasions. That's what we see out there. And so I'd love for you to share, you talk about three things to pay attention to when we talk about our customers' pain. If you could just go over those and we kind of comment on them.
Yes, I'd love to talk about those, because this has been a point of contention for me, knowing what I know about focus on the positive and you get more positive. And I tried to figure out how can I make marketing work for me, because there are some principles of marketing that make sense, but I think people take them to an extreme. So you mentioned how in traditional marketing, we're taught to call out people's pain. Yeah. And I understand why we do this, and there's actually a good practical reason for doing it. You know, when people are having a problem or they're having pain, they're thinking about that problem and thinking about that pain, and they're thinking about that problem, thinking about that pain, and it's chronic for them. So their reticular activating system is looking for anybody who's talking about their problem or pain, just like you're looking for a car or a baby or a pregnant woman. Right. So when we do our marketing, if you have a call out question, you know, and like, for example, one of the call out questions we use a lot is your business not growing fast enough? Or do you wish that you could put a fast forward on your business? Are you feeling overwhelmed or things like this, right? Because we know people are feeling overwhelmed. They are frustrated. They know they want their business to grow faster. And so we'll have a call out pain question. But the shift that I think we want to do differently in our marketing, and the thing I'm trying to let people know, is that you don't have to go into fear and making people feel shame for where they're at and all of that stuff. We want it to be more about empathy for their situation. And maybe the better word is compassion you know, sometimes empathy, and I think if you probably, like I do, deal with a lot of people who are empaths and are dealing in those kind of, and sometimes as somebody who's empathetic, you can take on that person's emotion. Right. And so what we're really looking for is, how can I be more empathetic to what they're going through? How can I talk about it in a way like, I get it. You know, let's look at what's happening. And instead of it being about, you're the guru and they're the ones who are should feel shameful or guilty. Now, what if it's more about the culture out there is telling us all of this stuff and we are feeling this way? What if it's more like us against the world? What if it's more of a feeling of like, I get you. And so having that emotional impact in the beginning of identifying their situation, but in an empathetic way, in a way of like, yeah, I see why you feel this way. And then understand how you are like them. Like, how is it that you've experienced that? Sometimes you've had your own transformation. Sometimes you've been exactly where they are. You know, how can you bring yourself into the equation more so that you have a bond with that client? And now they're listening. You know, now you've called out their pain, their reticular activating system has picked you up, they're listening to you. Now, if you can give them that third and final piece of that, it's not their fault, you know. And in my case, you know, I'd like to say it's not their fault, because we don't learn this stuff in school about how the brain works. We don't understand any of this. And each and every one of you, whether you're a weight loss coach, or whether you're helping people shift depression, or whether you're helping them as a money coach or whatever you're doing, you know that they didn't get here because they had the right education or the right tools or the right culture or the right support. They got where they're at, your client got where they're at, not through any fault of their own. And you're the person there now to say, I can guide you and bring you to this next place because you didn't know. You know, does that make sense, Sarah?
So much in there. Yeah, so much in there. I think the last, I mean, empathy, yeah, that's definitely the big centerpiece of the gentle marketing revolution. It's like, instead of leading with pain, let's lead with empathy. And yes, I agree, we need to still address the pain. But the other thing I think is that customers today are so much smarter because they have access to so much information. So they are already knowledgeable about the pain. You don't need to, you know, have like 2 pages explaining that pain and going like really into shaming them.
Makes you feel horrible. Even just 4 sentences on it, I can just feel like the yuck. And exactly. I don't want to bring people into my world through yuck. Yeah, I want to bring them into my world through joy.
Exactly. You know? Yeah. And then the part where it's like, it's not your fault. Yeah. So important. Like that, you know, what I'm doing with the gentle marketing revolution, I'm always saying it's not your fault. I was there too. The only access to marketing, everything we learn about marketing, it is the traditional marketing, is the fact that we are taught to be using pain and shame and manipulation. So it's not your fault if you're doing it. I've been doing that for 12 years because that's what I learned, right? So yeah, I think it's
a big piece. Do you know, can I say something about this too? And I don't want to throw men under the bus on this because we have a lot of men in the Train Your Brain sandbox too. But I think just as kind of a traditional testosterone, male-driven industry, marketing has probably, not even probably, for sure it's been dominated by men without a shadow of a doubt. You know, if you look at where we are up until today, that's where it's been. But I think we're seeing a shift now. And I think there's a revolution going on where women and people are getting more savvy. You know, most of our culture now, not my generation necessarily, but most of our culture has been raised in front of the TV, mm-hmm. and they've been advertised to since they could walk. And so they're cynical. They don't buy the traditional marketing anymore. And a lot of the kind of the, you know, male-based testosterone kind of marketing that's been going on for a long time, I think people are tired of it. And I think they're hip to it and they don't want it anymore. What they want is they want authenticity. They want the real you, and they want to feel like hopeful. They don't want to feel shameful. They want to feel hopeful. Like somebody can actually bring them to that next step.
And you mentioned inclusion as well. I think that's another big part. You know, so many online marketers are these gurus where they're like, oh, I figured it all out. I can teach you how to make 2 million in 2 weeks and just use my system. But I'm the guru, I'm teaching you, and you're just, you know, the lower level people. And so that's, that whole system is focused on exclusion. And it's like this king up here who teaches down there, but people want to be included nowadays. They want to, you know, the again, the customer today is much smarter than, you know, when in the time of TV ads. We're not just talking at people anymore. We're talking with people.
Yes. So, yeah. Totally true. And on that same note, I think this also gives permission to people to be experts faster, mm-hmm. because you don't have to be the guru to help somebody who is where you were 3 years ago. Right. You know, you just have to be, you know, we always use the analogy of the fifth grader helping the third grader. You know, right. you just have to be a few years ahead of the people who are in your clients, a few years further down your journey or that path. And it makes it more fun. They want to see that you're still banging around, figuring it out too. They want to take the journey with you.
Yeah, totally. I'm so glad that you're, you know, leading by example and really, yeah, focusing on that as well, because I think you're right. It is time for a revolution and people are ready. I can see signs everywhere that people are ready.
It's time without a doubt. And right back at you. I mean, this is so awesome that you're addressing this so point on with Gentle Business. I just love it.
Thank you. I've also, in doing my homework, I've also discovered your marketing superpower quiz.
Oh,
and so yes. fascinating, because I'm talking about superpowers in marketing as well. So I have quiz to
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Well, they're probably different concepts. This specifically is a quiz. It's yourmarketingsuperpower.com, and it's specifically a quiz to figure out the one thing that your natural gift is that you can actually use to market. So it doesn't feel like marketing anymore. Now it feels like just doing the thing you're already good at, you know?
Yeah, but that's so important, because what I'm doing with the Gentle Marketing Program is kind of reversing marketing. I'm saying, let's start with you as the entrepreneur first, rather than always focusing on our ideal client and client avatar. Let's figure out first who you are, what your values are, what you stand for, and what your superpower is. Because if you're in the situation where you're doing what everybody else tells you you should be doing, then clearly you're not acting in your zone of genius. So I thought,
oh my gosh, we're so simpatico. I can't stand it. That is the best, Sarah. I flippin' love that. Oh
yeah,
my gosh.
That's why
so
I was
good.
Like, oh wow, I'm going to use that quiz in the second module of the Gentle Marketing Revolution. It's all about the personal power. We go through a bunch of, you know, assessments and so that will be in there. For
gosh,
sure.
It's so good. I flippin' love that.
So I highly recommend it. Yeah. So it's yourmarketingsuperpower.com, right?
Yes, that's right.
And I took it and I'm the conductor. So.
And aren't you in the perfect spot? Oh, that's just great. I love it.
Yeah. So Dana, do you have any last words for my listeners who are all gentle marketers to, kind of really find their zone of genius and train their brain to be in that, to stay in their lane and do their own thing?
Thank you for asking that. You know, the key thing for what we train is feel good first, then take action. We call it intentional action. And so intentional action means if you're feeling frustrated or down or, you know, tired or overwhelmed, don't take action in your business that red hot second. Mm-hmm. Your job, your only job, is to feel good. And if you can make it your priority, and it doesn't have to take you 3 weeks to feel good, it could take you 3 minutes, right? But know that that's your priority. How can I be more happy, feel better in this moment at any time? How can I feel more hopeful in this moment at any time? Because if you can do that, now happiness is practical. When you feel good, when you take action, you're in the flow. When you feel good, you get access to better ideas. When you feel good, you show up better in the world. When you feel good, you like people better. They like you better and try to hold you back from action. So we're about being more aware in every moment of every day of doing whatever you can to feel good. And if the best you can feel is I need to take a nap and I need to be asleep for the rest of the day, do that. Hopefully you can get more and more and more hopeful every day. And if you can get more and more hopeful every day, that will take you the rest of the way there, because your brain is your best friend. And if you feel good, it will support you in finding everything you want. And so I would just say, make happiness a priority. It's the number one tool you've got for building your business.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for having this conversation with me, Dana. That has been on my wish list for a long time. Yay! So I'm so excited to talk to you. And you have a special link, danawild.com, gentle business. That's where yes. people can find the audio, right?
Yes. And please do download it. It's my favorite price for free. You get the whole book. And I just appreciate you having me here so much, Sarah. I love the work you're doing. And I'm so excited that I've discovered you.
Thank you. Thank you so much for spending some time with me. I hope you enjoyed this episode as much as I enjoyed recording it. Absolutely check out the Train Your Brain audiobook that Dana graciously shares with the listeners of this show for free at danawild.com/gentlebusiness. That's how I first really got to know Dana when I was listening to an episode on someone else's podcast. And so I downloaded the ebook. It's not an ebook, it's an audiobook. I downloaded the audiobook and just started listening to it on my daily walks. And I hope you'll do the same thing, because I really think it can help. The other free giveaway that she has is the Marketing Superpower Quiz at yourmarketingsuperpower.com. Also take a look if that's of interest to you. You find the show notes at sarahsenacroce.com/GBR27. All the other resources we mention on this episode will be in there. If you're new to this show and haven't downloaded my one-page gentle marketing mandala with the 7 email prompts to help you on this journey to a gentler marketing paradigm, please go over to sarahsenacroce.com/1, the number 1, page. I hope you'll join me on this journey to a kinder marketing paradigm. Please invite your friends to join us. This is really a gentle revolution, and we need more people to bring this message into their business. And you can do that by sharing the Gentle Business Manifesto with them or this episode, and both can be found at thegentlebusinessrevolution.com. And yeah, a review on iTunes would really make my day as well. So if you have a moment, please go over to iTunes and share with me what you think about this show. Let's be the change we want to see in the world. Talk to you next week.